just want to live in you. Lord, we thank you, God. Lord, the word declared that you came as a propitiation for our sins, God. And Lord, there is nothing that we can give, there's nothing that we can offer that would merit all that you've done for us, God. And Lord, there is no work we could have done, no day we could have kept, God. No, nothing, God, in our human ability to deserve all that you've done for us. But through your amazing grace, God, we are here today. And Lord, we are indeed thankful to you, Lord God. Alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, God, but Lord, you chose us, God. We were not a people, Lord, become a people by your blood, Almighty God. Lord, how we thank you, Jesus. Lord, remember your people wherever they may be today, Lord. For the plans ahead with Simone, God, and Burkaville, Lord God, we're putting before you. Burr Lambert, Lord God, and they're planning, God, and it's sometimes a distressing time as they would move forward, Lord God, but Lord, we are committing all things in your hands, God. For the youth meeting, God, for the camp, Lord God, for the varying things, Lord. For the things in our lives that would come with this morning, God, the load. But Lord, we come knowing that you say, cast our cares upon you because you care it for us, Almighty God. Lord, we come, and Lord, there is no intention for us to leave the way we came, God. Lord, we want to commit all things in your hands this morning, Almighty God. Lord, we love you, Lord. Lord, we adore you, Almighty. As we come, Lord God, not knowing the things that we need to say or what we want to say, God, but Lord, that Lord, you'll come and you know what your people are in need of this morning. And Lord, take the word in our hearts. You speak a word to your people this morning. As they come with open hearts, God, and in great anticipation to hear from you, Lord, I have nothing to say, God. Therefore, Lord, if you don't come and say something, they will hear nothing today, Almighty God. Lord, let the words of our mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Lord, we thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Psalm 51, and it reads from verse 1 through to 12. David, in his writing, he says, have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according to the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity, and cleanse me from my sins. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee only, have I sinned, and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest, and be clear when thou judgest. Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part thou shalt make me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness, that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. Hide thy face far from my sins, and blot out all mine iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Amen. Amen. You may be seated for a moment. a psalm of David, and a beautiful psalm. It's apart from the Lord's Prayer and the other psalm, which is the prayers, is a very popular psalm. It's a psalm of necessity. Amen? Amen? It's today's youth service, ain't it? Brother Junior is waving me off. It's not youth service. Today's not the third Sunday. Huh? So you're moving the third Sunday to next week. It's a popular psalm, and it becomes a psalm of comfort to some, Berber Mackey, that as David found himself in a pickle, because David, when his army was out, that sometimes the devil find work for hand lands are true. Now, try go. That here was David walking upon his balcony and looking over and saw this woman, and from his vantage point, she must have been doing something to catch his eyes. I think somebody says she might have been like in a, there was a bathroom or something. I don't know what she was in, but he saw her in a way that he couldn't keep going. He kept looking and kept looking. And I say to young people all the while, if you look one time, it's one thing. Yes, embarrassment. Somebody passed on the road, you look one time, it's one thing. But when you look a second time, you start to get it in trouble. You know, you see it one time, you pass by Mackey, it's one thing. But you deliberately now go to look a second time, you're getting into trouble. You're getting into trouble. And so this is what David did. And David invited her over, and she came to the king's command, because the king was king. He was a man who ruled the province, and those who dwell there were his subjects and must obey his command. And he was taken over by her. She got pregnant, I realize, by scripture. And she was the wife of one valiant soldier. And so when David found out all of this, David sent for him and said, come, man. You've been fighting for so long. Go and stay with your wife, man. Go on. Go to stay with her for a moment, man. And she's been missing you. Yeah? I'm trying to be smart. Though you were smart, but the man had a greater persuasion. And he refused to go into his wife. He stayed on the outside. David said, no, man. The man said, I cannot enjoy the comfort of the embrace of my wife while my soldiers are in the battlefield fighting. You're a man of integrity. And David found that he couldn't persuade him to take in Jamaican terms, to take the jacket. Because David was trying to jacket him. And he would not. Something, he would not take that. He didn't even know that, but he just wouldn't take that. He was not going to wear that one. David said, we'll find the next way out, because it's going to bring shame on the kingdom. David said, put him in the battle, man. Put him at the front. And then step away and leave him. David didn't actually go out there to kill him, but David was a murderer. You see what I'm saying? And with that, here comes a prophet to him, and he brought a conviction upon David. And David, it was of such that when David began to realize what he has done, he said, have mercy upon me, O God. I wonder if you understand what we're talking about this morning, that have mercy upon me, O God. Don't look, but because of thy loving kindness, David was appealing to a side of God, don't it? He came to God and was appealing to a certain side of God, because he knew that God is a God of judgment. He was a God, because he said to Saul, go down and utterly destroy. He was a God that deals with judgment, a God of wrath, a God of vengeance. But David knew he was also a merciful God. Have mercy upon me according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. It seemed a pride that is befitting to our daily walk. Huh? Because we are encompassed by different things on a daily basis. That we find ourselves in a pickle all the time. You might not believe it. I must be the only person who have these kind of situations sometimes. That sometimes I remember we used to You say, Lord, I'm not going there. You know, you feel yourself strong. I'm not going to do this, bro. I'm not going to feel, push out your chest and walk. But the moment you reach a certain spot, you turn off and find yourself as I'm waiting. Lord Jesus Christ. You're dead now. Open up. Tomorrow morning, you wake up, you realize you never did. You say, oh, yes, I never died last night. These things don't happen to you, don't it? Sometimes this mic seems not to be working. I can't hear sometimes. Forgive me. Okay, Brother Oral is severely chastising me from the back end. If I take a writing here and we talk about, this morning we're talking about the perfection by the word in God's time. So we are being perfected by the word in God's time. Because there are times when we baptized Tim this morning, and Brother Mackey, when we came to God as young believers, the same thing happened to a lot of people. We think that now we've been baptized, this is it, we're good. We're sweetly saved and sanctified. But when the time rolled on for a little bit, we begin to have a very kind of rude awakening. That when we thought that we were sanctified and saved and will not have temptations and problems anymore, we find the very same things that we thought we left behind were right beside us all the time. And the very thing that we think that, yes, I will never do this again, we find us that they're doing the very same thing. Are you with me? Paul says, I find a law in my members that when I would do good, I'm doing evil. That evil is present with me all the time. The things that I should do, I do not. The things that I should not do, these are the things I find myself doing. Why am I doing this? I go to church, I praise God, I'm baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I even shake in the spirit. But God, I find myself doing the same things. Your perfection is a process. And justification, sanctification, baptism of the Holy Ghost, that's a three walk of grace, the three work of grace. And so when we come, we talk about justification that we've just reached. Can I read something here that I came upon years ago? Read it before. Let me do it again. It's a blog. I was reading a blog. You with me? I was reading a blog, and it's years ago I read this. Okay, I'm being blown away. You know what, and those who know, you understand what a blog is, don't you? A blog is like a website or a part on a website there that allows people. And it's also, Twitter is a blogging. You know, your Twitter account is like a blogging situation. You come up with an idea, you have a thought, and you post it, and you're expressing your thought, but within that, people are allowed to respond to what you're saying. So you keep a thread of a conversation going in your blog, and there is a video one also that they do. But then this one is written by a Jew, and he said, Jews, I don't know if it will fit into what we're talking about, but I like it. It said, Jews, we cannot be a part of the United Nations. We are a people that dwells alone, and among the peoples is not reckoned. By relying on non-Jews, we postpone the ultimate redemption, which will come only when we are so pitifully alone. When it will be obvious that Israel has no one to rely on except the Almighty. For so long as the Jews has even one ally, he will be convinced in his smallness of mind that his salvation came from that ally. It is only when he is alone, against all of his own efforts and frantic attempts, that he will, through no choice of his, be compelled to turn to God. We do not want acceptance or integration. We do not want to be the same or to fit in. We cannot give up our heritage. Such is a crime, and postpone the coming of the righteous Messiah. I don't know if you understand all that I just said. But here is a Jew and a rabbi saying, as long as we have somebody to support us. So we're talking about Brother Smith. that faith and all these things. As long as you have your money in your pocket, is your money give you, don't it? As long as you can get this from somewhere, then you get it from somewhere. But when you are alone and at your wit's end and don't know where to turn, here's a Jew saying, until you come to that place, you don't know what it is to turn to God. That you got to turn to God, and Him alone will be your sustenance. Him alone. As long as there's someone to sustain you, then your sustenance is not God, you say. It's coming from somewhere else. As long as you can work your way, then your righteousness is not of God. As long as you can do this and do that, I got to stop my smoking. As long as you can stop it, you don't need God. As long as you can stop moving to certain music, you don't need God. As long as I can stop doing this, I don't need God. Because if you stop doing it, never God stop it. But there comes a place in your life when you got no more desire for. That's a different place to reach. You stopping don't mean you don't have a desire, Brethren. You just decide stop. And oftentimes when you do that, you find you're going back to the very same thing. But you got to come to a place when you don't have no more desire to go. No more desire to do. You've lost the longing for. That's when God is working on you. Because there are times when we're trying to. There are times when we're trying to figure out the mind of God. We're trying to understand what God is doing and where God is taking us. Because there are times when we expect that God is going to keep us on this plane. But I'll tell you this one thing, young people, that God is perfecting you not upon the mountaintops. Your perfection is not up in the mountaintops, but your perfection is through trials and through testing and through tribulation. In the valley, He restoreth my soul. That as long as it is smooth and sailing, there's nothing God needs in your life. It's a point of stagnation. But you find that when you go down, is a time that you're going up. It might sound strange, don't it? But in the lowest moment in your life, in the time where you think there is no God, where you think that I'm all alone, and you're being overtaken by circumstance, oh, don't give up, my friend. Don't give up, my brother and sister, because He's right there with you. Because He promised never, never to leave me alone. The message of Super Saiyan, the prophet said, God knows the end from the beginning. Therefore, He could plan everything that it could work out just to His glory. You believe that? He's working it out for His glory. He's working it out for your good also. He said the clock is ticking just exactly on time. We think we must do this or that now, but remember, God's clock will be just exactly on time. All these things has to be this way. It has all got to be done according to His great knowledge, His foreknowledge, for by foreknowledge He could predestinate, not by His desire, but by His knowledge. God doesn't predestinate by His desire. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But by His foreknowledge, He knew who would accept it and who would not. Therefore, He could make everything work according to His big time clock. Because He could tell the beginning from the end. So whatever you're going through, as we talk for a few minutes, that whatever you're going through, when you realize your life meanders a certain kind of way, and we want to question God,
We could take the story of Joseph. That Joseph stood here and God gave him a sign in a dream. And he said the stars and the moon and all these, they bowed down before him. He saw the end. He was standing at the beginning. But God never showed him the journey. You believe me? God did not show him the journey. He saw the glory at the end. Became excited. And went and tell his friends, his family. Immediately as the word came out of his mouth. His father knew what it meant. His mother knew what it meant. His brethren knew what it meant. But he was a young boy and was happy. Oh, we see all these bounding before him. He saw the end, but did not see the journey. He did not know that one day they were going to throw him into a pit. He did not know they were going to sell him to one stranger passing by. Who's going to take him into Egypt and sell him into slavery? You don't understand where we are with this. That you think that what you're going through, that you are alone. And you don't understand that the footsteps of the righteous are ordered by the Lord. And you've been to some place and don't know why I'm here. And you try some things and they fail. And you try this and it failed. I tried that and it failed. But what is God doing to you? He's ordering your steps by the word. And he's perfecting you by the word in his time. For though the vision tarry, it must come to pass. Don't it? It must come to pass. If God gave you, and you are certain that God gave you, don't let go. If God gave you and you're certain that God gave you that vision, don't let go off of that vision. Because if you let go, you're going to miss it. But you got to be sure it's God give you the winner. And you never eat late. And something happens when you're weak. And the night you have kind of dream and you realize it have nothing to do with God. Then the Bible says dreams come through a multitude of business, don't it? But here is Joseph with a dream. And Joseph came to a point that he was there doing very well. And apparently was growing into a very handsome young man. He must have muscles and a six-pack or something like that. Because whatever about him, that Potiphar's wife looked on him and desired him. He was no little shrimp and looking funny kind of man. He must have some of the big shoulders and standing above a lot of them and looking very handsome. That she liked this one and she want this one. Yeah? And she move off him. And even him said, no. She tore off a piece of his garment, don't it? And then by that, he was in prison for years. But you believe, oh, could that be the plan of God? Oh, could you being in prison, Brother Smith, be the plan of God? Oh, could you sitting there for years being the plan of God? How could? But he could not ascend to the position before going to the lowest point in his life. You got to be taken to a low place where you can depend only on God. It's not by might, it's not by power, but it by thy spirit, said the Lord. A place that you can go no further. The next place from that is death. The only place Joseph can go after that is death. In the dungeons of Pharaoh. And in the dungeon, he did not lose his integrity. He did not lose his vision. He did not lose his grip on Almighty God. He held true to what he believed in. Though the storms keep on raging in your life, and sometimes you cannot tell night from day, but the hope that lay within me is still assured as I keep my eyes, because my soul is anchored in God. You got to stay anchored. He's perfecting you in his time, but you got to stay anchored. You got to keep abiding in the word. And while there, One man had a dream. And he did not understand the dream. And here's Joseph telling him, you're going to get back your position. He was the baker, right? He was a baker. The butler get back his position. And the other man was a baker. He said, but you are going to die. What a bad thing to tell a man one time. You're going to die and you're going to get back your position. Man, you're mad, man. You're a man. Type of foolishness. But within that is a plan of God. Now, while that was happening, here it was that the butler was returned to his position. You understand how God began to work now? And here is Joseph. Might have had despondence in his life and sitting there and don't remember. And I might be losing something. You're losing grip on God, you know? Because the thing is taking so long, you're losing your grip. Your hands getting a little bit weak. But when Joseph began to see the working of God, that the butler, that the baker was dead and the butler was being elevated, he said, remember me when you return to the kingdom. Remember me down here. And I want you to know it wasn't the next day. It wasn't the next day. It wasn't the next month. It was another long time Joseph was sitting in the prison. I wonder if God not here. I wonder if God. Because Job did not curse God. But he got to question some things. If you don't question some things, then there's something wrong with you, you know. You've got to question. But God, you tell me. The prophet said he's guilty of his word until he brings it to pass. So I can question God on his word. God, you gave me a vision that all these will bow before me. But I am still in prison. I see you bring a word of comfort. The butler was restored. The baker is in the grave. But I am still in the dungeons of Pharaoh God. There are people around me that have been blessed with God. Where is my blessing? I see my neighbor, them have new care house, God. But I don't have nothing. What happened to me? What happened to me, God? Make some drops fall on me. No, Jesus, look at drops fall on me. Me not ask for much, Jesus, but a little job so the blessing fall on me. Stood there, maybe heavily bearded, hair's long, way down, hair long down, facial hair long to, of years I've been in prison. But you know what? Even though it is not looking the way I want it to look, but God a God. Master God, a God. That God, even if I don't come out of this jail, that don't change you from being God. Even if I'm not delivered, then you are still God. And even if God, I will not let go of the things that I believe in, though my friends might leave me, though everything, all that might turn against me, but God, I won't leave of the thing that which have committed unto me. And he stood there. But God is working on two ends. Because while he's talking to his God, God is troubling Pharaoh in such a way that Pharaoh is having a dream and the dream stop and never finish. And then go back a dream and the dream continue. And when he's done, he don't remember the dream. Him start the dream, wake up and go back in bed and the dream continue. And when he's done, he still remember the dream. And he said, God, what is this? But whatever it was, it troubled him so bad. It troubled him and he said, bring in the soothsayers, bring in the magician, bring in the wise men, bring all of them and tell him, said, somebody need to tell me what I had dreamt and interpret the dream for me. What an impossible Pharaoh. What an impossible Pharaoh that is. That's an impossibility. Am I going to know what your dream said, Brasmith? How am I going to know what your dream say? And I must come tell you what you dream and then tell you what the dream mean. Yeah. Give me a hint, man. Give me a little hint. Jeff, give me a hint, man. So give me something to work with. And here it is that when they bring them and he said, if any man can tell me, I go and cover him in a purple, put a ring upon his finger, I'm going to elevate him. Anybody can tell me this. But if you can't tell me, you know, you're going to serious trouble. Your wisdom and your magic trick have got into the fire. And when it came around and nobody could say, even the man who had his dream interpreted, forget about the interpreter, you know. He totally forgot about Joseph, you know. He totally forgot Joseph was in prison. But when it came time, it's God's clock we're working with, you know. It's not in your time, but it's in God's time. That when it became time, the dream of Pharaoh and the predicament reached the ears of the butler. And he said, but wait. He said, go tell the king. I need an audience with him. And when he said, oh, king, live forever. I cannot tell you the dream, nor the interpretation thereof. But there is a man in your dungeon. There is a man in the dungeon who has this great gift that he could tell you your dream and tell you what it means. I don't know. The king was so desperate. The king wouldn't fit the prisoner. He was desperate because he was troubled. And Joseph moved from that position, from the guttermost to the uttermost. That when even the people of Israel, all of Egypt, all the generals of Egypt, no matter who they were, when Joseph stepped out, they got to bow their knees to Joseph. You got to hold a little longer. Take Jesus at his word. He's going to take you through. It is not you. It is not your time. It is not where you come from. Because there are times when look at where we come from, or who we are, or what we have done in our lives. But look at Jesus and where he came from. When some thought it wouldn't work, there comes Joshua, walk up. Sorry, before I even reach Joshua, there in Genesis 38 was one girl who some people might say, boy, it's an abomination. But when she needed to bring forth seed, she disguised as an harlot and slept with her father-in-law. But in that sleeping with him, she took from him something of significance. You understand what we're talking about? Her name was Tamar, don't it? But when she took his signet, his ring, his staff, and she took something from him. And when he heard 3 months later that she was pregnant, he said, bring her, come, let me stone her. She must die by death. Come, bring her, come. And when she came, she did not have no fear of death. Because something moved her differently. Huh? And she came to a place, and when they were about to say, hold on a little bit, give me a word. He said, this ring, this staff, is anybody's bracelet? Is it anybody who that belong to? They are the father of this. I feel them on this. And when they pick it up, Judah said, for she is more righteous than I am. She played the harlot, didn't she? Jesus, great, 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 great grandmother, that's enough. You're talking about where you come from, who you are, and about the perfection of God in your life. It's not about where you have been. It's not about what you have done. It's about the goodness and grace of God. Here is Joshua step across Jordan, and when he came up, he sent someone and said, go up into Jericho, go look for, go see what can go on in Jericho. But when they came into Jericho, one woman pulled them in and said, listen, we've heard everything about Israel. Our hearts are trembling. There is no strength in the men of the city because of you and your God. But give me a true token. Give me a true token. You with me? She wants a sign, a true sign from God. She was a prostitute, a ill-famed woman. You talk about who you are. She went after the city fell. She was married to Salmon, a general in Israel, of whom came Jesus Christ. She's a great, great, great grandmother of Jesus Christ. You're talking about where you come from. The seed is passing through all of this. And you might think that God cannot dwell within this body. I've been to so much places and I've done so much things that God cannot find pleasure here. But it's not your doing. Lot and him daughter, them sleep together, didn't we? Didn't he? And from that sleeping with Lot and him daughter, you got Moab, don't we? But one day, something touched a woman named Naomi. And she got to walk out of Israel. She never really wanted to go because she's not supposed to do that. It's against what God brought, like a famine in the land. She had need to leave the land. If she did not leave, Ruth could not come. It's God's time. It's God's clock. It's nothing, it's not your time. You're just going to sit in, man. It's like a train. Just sit in, man, and enjoy the ride. You're going to go down some valley, up some hill. But when she go across the land, she met upon Ruth and Orpah. And on they were about to leave. Everybody died. And she said, boy, God cursed me, look like. You see, because me left the land, God cursed me because me leave the land. And she said, boy, you know, I go back home. Orpah said, boy, I'm going back home. I don't know. Ruth said, entreat me not to leave me. Not return from following after thee. Anywhere you go, same place me under the too. Anywhere you lodge, same place. Your God shall be my God. There must have been, though, something in Naomi's life that affected Ruth a positive way. Something in her life that she's saying to her, anywhere you go, I will go. Brother Smith said, make sure you live a life in him house that him know, say. You never tell him, boy, I say, boy, I got to serve God. Because he make sure him hold up an example before him. That him, whether him want or not, something going to move him by the example before him. By the example that he's seeing all the time. and so Ruth, looking at that example, said, whatever you have, I want that. She's an outcast. Came out of incest. Father and daughter relation brought the tribe of Moab. She's from Moab. Should not come in the presence of Israel for the rest of their life. But here is one that walked through and through the grace of God. You who was not a people. You who had no inheritance. You who had, who had no position. You had nothing, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel. But she walked back into Israel and everybody knew who she was. But on the instructions from the word of her mother-in-law, who knew the word, he said, is that field there? Go over there, sir. Just follow what I say. And just do enough. You don't have to... You don't have to dress anyway strange, Bremak. You don't have to dress or do anything. You don't have to dance and swirl. But just conduct yourself a certain way. And when she did that, she caught the eyes of the owner, of the plantation owner. You realize that? Other ladies were there. But this one, she walk a little different. She mannerism a little different. She's not playing around with the man them and things like that. She's different. Something about her, there's a mark upon her. Who she? He started to inquire, who she? And Boaz and Ruth were married, and they got Obed, and Obed had Jesse. And Jesse had David. You walking with me? That what you thought would not be God's way is the way God chose. A prostitute. He chose one who sleep with our father-in-law. He took one who came out of incest. No connection. You saw God that you was come down the line. But you talk about you. You're looking at where you came from. Can I say to you, it's not where you came from. Where you think you're from is not where you're from. I sound like a philosopher this morning, don't I? Where you think you're from is not where you are from. Making sense? I came from God. So I go back to God, Brother Kevin. If I did not come from God, I could not go back to God. For the foundation of the Lord standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his. I came from God. I go back to God. God know the end that is where the beginning. He looked down at that, and by his foreknowledge, he knew the decisions I would make. He knew the choice and the place that I've gone. But with that knowledge, he put a seed germ of life in there that must come forth in his time. Must come forth in his time. And you wonder why you're here. You wonder why you're different. You wonder why some things don't appeal to you. It's not because you're born under a certain sign. No Gemini, no Pisces, no Taurus. That has nothing to do with the plan of God. That has to do with your mortal man. But one of these days, you're going to step out of mortal into mortality. Though people are seeing you walking around in the 16 elements, but you are not there. You're walking around, you talk with them, but you have moved into a new dimension. God has taken you across a new dimension. Though you're walking in this 16 elements, I am not. Woo! I am in a new dimension. You see me, but you don't see me. You see me, but you don't see me. You see this, but the real me, the real me is in the presence of Almighty God. You might see my feet stumble down. I feel so unworthy. Most times I feel so unfit. But there's one thing about it, and I'm gonna shout it. I'm not about to quit. That is not in my DNA. I can't quit. I can't turn back. No matter what it come. Because I'm not perfecting myself. The perfection is in God. And he's working it out for his purpose in his time. You may win a battle every now and then. Every now and then you win a battle. You lose some, you win some, you lose some, you win some. But these are small battles. In the great war, you have already won the war. The war is already won. You have small battles to fight. You have your own desires to wrestle with. You have all these things to deal with on a day-to-day basis. But there is a greater is he who have fought all my battles for me. And the victory is mine for the claiming. Understand what God think of you. Or think about you. The Almighty thinks, boy, what will you think of yourself? Because God says, my ways are not your ways. Neither my thoughts, your. For as heaven is above the earth, so are my from your thoughts. And as the east is from the west, so are my ways from your ways. So there are times you think yourself losing and a loser and all these things, but that's not God's thought of you. You see, you're looking in the present tense. God is looking in the future. He know that you have already overcome. He know that you're already seated in heaven place with Christ Jesus. He know that you are not even right here. This is a time span that's going through the commotion. But the part of you, for my theophany, I hear it calling me. You understand what I'm saying? My theophany, I hear it. And it's saying, come up a little higher into the perfect word. Come up a little higher into the agape love. Come up a little higher, soar through the heavenly, my theophany, it's calling me, it's calling me. Every rung go higher and higher. God see you as already being perfect. I think of God talking to Adam in his creation. of the perfect God talking to his perfect creation, his perfect son and his perfect creation, Bermaki. And I think about the people with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, because they then had not the baptism of the Holy Ghost the way it came after Acts chapter 2. Amen? No, we have the baptism of the, and Jesus said, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Yeah? And I'm going to send your comforter to dwell with you, even the Spirit of truth whom the world cannot receive, but you're going to receive the Spirit of truth. Amen? Amen. So God is talking to Adam as his perfect son. But here are we with the literal life of God in us, walking around. I'm thinking, Brother Kevin, the perfect God talking to his perfect son in his perfect creation, in this dispensation. We're not looking back then, but you don't see perfection, do you? You see yourself have been stained and damaged and marred and all these things. But God is seeing you through a different lens. He's looking through a different lens. For you are perfect, wanting nothing in his sight. Don't depend. Don't just look on your pitfalls. Today you're up, tomorrow you're down. Today you're up, tomorrow you're down. Today you're up. Tomorrow you're down. Tomorrow you're down. Tomorrow you're down. And see, I mean, I'll go back up again. But stay down so long, like, you know, I'll go back up again. But you know what thing about it? Brother Dalton, I always love this story, told a long time. You talk about it all the way, Brother Dalton, on the back. That the eagle soaring high. But after a certain time, when he reached about 30 years old or thereabout, he began to grow things on his beak. And his talons begin to come and his feathers begin to get old and just falling out and things like that. And he can't soar the height he used to soar anymore. He can't do the things he used to do. The beak grow things and come. He can't grab things the way he used to do with his beak because the weight has grown. So he got to come down to the valley. He can't stay on the mountaintop. The eagle got to go down to the valley. And he stays there in the valley. And what is he doing? He hit his beak against a rock. Oh, the rock of salvation is there all the time. And he hit his beak against a rock until the extra begin to fall off. The talons on his toe begin to drop out. The feathers come off and he's bare and naked. He cannot depend on himself no more. He cannot depend on himself no more. He's got to wait there. Hiding himself from different animals who take him. Run and hide. I got to hide because something is about to take me. Oh, it is a process of Almighty God. It's God working on the eagle. Feathers out. Can't eat, can't kill nothing. But the great big eagle got to fly over the top. Somebody's got to fly over and drop some spiritual food in due season. Drop something that he can feed on. Feed on a little bit here, a little bit there, because God will provide a widow to sustain thee in the time of drought, in the time when you have nothing. God's going to provide a raven to sustain you. So God is working on the great big eagle. That eagle, sometimes when they spread their wings at certain eight, you have 20 feet. From the tip of one wing to the other wing. You imagine that's a giant bird. When you spread your wings, that almost when the bird spread the wings, why is that the church? The church is 30 feet, but almost the width of the church from tip to tip. That's a giant bird. And he's down there. Normally anything fly past him can pick it up. You ever see how eagle pick up a snake? And about the snake a curl and turn. You just hold on to the snake and bite him two times like that. And snake have settled down. But down in the valley, you are susceptible to different kinds of attacks. Different things are going to come your way. But listen, man, it is a work of God. Some things you're putting your hands to don't come through. They fail. You're trying at this, it don't work. And it seems like God is against you or somebody have them hand in your life. Listen to me, it's not nobody have hand in your life, but God is working out something in you that you cannot see right now. But I tell you, like Joseph, you got to hold on to your integrity. You got to hold on to the true word of God. You can't give up now. You can't turn back. You've come too far to turn around. What are you going to turn back to? Where are you going back? And to whom shall you go? But while he's there and beating his beak against the rock and his talons falling out and the scales on the legs dropping off, the feathers out, he's naked like a chicken you just plucked, don't it? Naked like a chicken, and the baby feathers begin to come back out and spring, and the beak begin to harden a little bit, and he's down there for a while. And though you may slay me, God, yet will I trust you. Lord, I'm not going to leave you. For though I go through the fire, you are there. The water shall not overflow me. Lord, I believe you. Lord, I will not leave you, God. For you are God alone. Oh, and there is no other God beside thee. God, I got to go through. You can't stop. You've got to go through. There's no escaping that. You've got to go through. And while he's there, the beak begin to harden. The tail feathers begin to come. The feathers on the wing begin to come, but he's not ready yet. He might stretch it sometimes. That wing out there naked and run down a stretch in the valley. Just trying to exercise himself. Trying to exercise, but it's not time to take off yet. And as the feathers begin to come, I'm going to soar a little bit and stop. I'm going to soar a little bit and stop. I got to keep exercising my faith. I got to keep exercising my faith. The faith is not enough to take me up to the heavens. But the faith is now. It's going to take me there. I'm exercising my faith in small things. Because if you've been faithful in small things, I'm going to make you ruler over bigger things. That when the enemy comes in like a flood, hey, I'm going to step over you. Hey. For what is a mountain to an eagle flying high? Woo! And now God, he's there, and as the feathers begin to come, he soared 5 feet, then he soared 20 feet, then he's going down, and he goes further. This time he goes up a tree and stay on a branch. Wow, this feels good. Begin to feel the wind blowing in his chest, and he's saying, yes, God, yes, God, yes, God. And he's saying, and the eagles up above fly. He said, come up a little higher. A little higher. A little higher. Come up, my brother. Come up, my sister. Move. This is a moving day. Move a little closer. Where the... Hallelujah. But you know what? One of the days when he's there, when he stretched those big wings out and just stay there and go, phew, 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 and begin to do that. And he begins to lift off like a rocket, just slowly rising. Phew, phew, and the big wings begin to fan, and all the dust around begin to just spin up and things like that. And here is the eagle, and he's soaring. And he's going up and higher and higher and higher. And higher, and higher, and higher, and... Whoa! Hey! Can I cut the word of the preacher? He said, take a look at those Egyptians. Look at those Egyptians that you thought were your masters, that held you captive, that held you bound, that held you entangled, that you can move and you're shackled by them. But here comes the great Jehovah, and he says, look at them, for you shall see them no more. No more. After today, no more. This is your day of salvation. It's God's work in God's time. The perfect God talking to you is perfect child. Though you may not see it in the perfect creation you're dwelling in, you may not see it also. But you see, you're living in a different dispensation, in a different dimension rather. You have stepped from this into another. Though people might see you, but there is more to you than meet the eye. That people might see you as failing, as no good, as worthless, as you have nothing good about you, you're not going nowhere. Who, that? That you're not going nowhere, man. That you're top. Look at me now. I'm not going to sing. I'm not going to sing, but look at me now. Eh? Look at me now. Yeah? When I thought you wouldn't be. Hey. I like to tell them there are times. There's somebody who influenced me greatly, Burr Smith. When I was a little boy living at Woodview Avenue, I used to slide down the road, put an old plastic thing, and rub out the whole pants bottom. There's a girl living on the same road. She used to laugh at me just up the road. And Woodview, they used to laugh at me every day. Burr Mackey. But I drive past the road there, I see her. I'm just drive past her and look at her. So she walking on the road, and I say, if I never get the grace of God, I'll stop and say, look at me now. Yeah, man. She lived by the same place where she was living. I used to live down the road, yes, sir. And she used to laugh at me. I'm going to pass her. I'm pass her. I smile to myself. I'm say, she wouldn't know. She turned the same place. See, everything same. Nothing to change. She walked the same way and everything like that. I'm going to say, look at me now. Oh, eh? I should stop and introduce myself. I said, remember me? You remember me? You used to laugh at me. And things like that. But you know anything about it? We're not going to do that. A grace of God. A grace of God. I grew up on a Commodore, sir. I used to play football with one of them on the road. Go play football and sing, and we go party and all the things on the roadside. But one day, God, the grace of God touched me. My mother said, come to church with me this Sunday, man. Come, you walk past the church. And we go to church this Sunday morning and baptize the evening. Me never stop again from that. The people, them, Brother Mackey, when they hear me baptize, the whole of Commodore run come up at the church. Because I said, we the walk one. But the last time we did one party, we go out last night and to the next. They said, people come out. Because I said, boy, walk one. The crew come up. The whole of the crew come up. But today, some of them down there sit on my roadside, see a way, and dig out and mingle and thing like that. I could have been there. I could be just the same. There is no different that way. But God. Brother Mackey, you know what I'm talking about. Brother Smith, you know what I'm talking about. It's but God. Some of you could be in jail today. Could have been dead already. Man could have married. But God. But God. And then we behave as if we have done it by ourselves. That we are here by our own doing. And our own working. If it had not been for the Lord who was on your side. Where would you be? But when we come to church, we fail to give him thanks. We fail to praise him. We fail to lift him up like as if we are our own salvation. Let me tell you something. If it had not been for God. Young people, you don't understand what we're talking about. I talked to Bruce this morning. There are days when, as a young boy, we used to be on fasting for 3 days. From Friday to Sunday, me go school pan fasting and come back home Saturday, Sunday, non-stop, night and day. A fervor, a fever in our bodies for God. We want more and more and more. We walk for miles to church. I came from school and then dropped my bag and turned my car key down. Pass the stoplight, a bug walk, and go down and play song. I said, go play a drum and thing, a crusade, and walk, come back up with me during the night time. And today, if no vehicle not carry you, not going, who am I talk to? I mean, if you have this for God. It's where we come from, Brother Connie. We are on a thing there. You understand? When we had nothing, we had God. But now God bless you with something you don't want to do, God. We had nothing, but we had God. And we wanted to serve God. But God bless you and your family with something. And we don't want nothing like that. If we not get no drive, we not go. If rain starts falling, we not go. When we just have a center here, so on a rose hall center, walk from Commodore coming to church one Sunday, rain starts to fall. Me have one jacket, you know, one plaid jacket, thick. Brother Mackey, when I reach a church, the jacket heavy like a 10-pound of cement tonight. Me say, man, the jacket soak. Me wait to come to church, you know.
And me never turn back, you know. Now nah, I turn back. So come. When me come, me hang on my jacket around, so. And tamp on the back. Do me wet. Tamp on the back. Me come to church same way. That's not now stop you from come. Not now stop you from serve your God. Not now stop you from worship your God. Because God inhabits the praises of his people. So when you come to church, we wonder, why not now go on that church? Everything's a dead. If you not bring something, how you expect something to go on? We come and want somebody to do for us. But you got to put something in. Else you get nothing out. If you go to the bank and load up the money and go withdraw and get something, you must be a criminal. Something wrong. If you go draw the bank and have the money, you're not supposed to get nothing at all. But if you want something, you must put something in. Bring something, man. We come to worship God. And everybody comes sit down. And I say, praise the Lord. And everybody go. Then the one about this them. See, the Anita always tell me, say, oh, you love dance. When me come up and somebody comes down, brother Glenn. And so when me start to dance, who don't like it, bite it. Because me come to give God a praise. I don't care about you sitting in the back. If you don't like it, do something about it. But me not tap. Me not tap. Because me not come to see you. Me not come to praise you. Me not come about you. When we come, as a God will come about. I'm going to bring my prayers. Bring your prayers your way. And I bring my way. We want something to move with our lives. You got to sometimes forget about the prayer. Remember, something, some obstacles in your way, you got to forget about the prayer. And we get to thank God. Thank God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. In the move yet. But you got to start to thanking God. You pray about it already. You pray already. You tell God already. You keep on telling him. Listen, my man. I begin to thank God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You have obstacles in your life. Thank you, Jesus. Me fall down yesterday, but God, I thank you. Have mercy upon me according to that loving kindness. Thank you, Jesus. You want to hear the rest of the scripture, sir? David says, then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners will be converted unto thee. He said, deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God, thou God, and my tongue shall sing aloud of thy righteousness. O Lord, open thou my lips, and my mouth shall show forth thy praise. For thou desirest not in sacrifice, else will I give it. Thou delightest not in burnt offering. The sacrifice of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. O God, thou would not despise. Do good in thy good pleasure unto Zion. Build thou the walls of Jerusalem. Then shalt thou be pleased with the sacrifice of righteousness, with burnt offering and all burnt offering. Then shall they offer bullocks upon thine altar. And sinners will be converted unto you. Open thou my mouth, and my lips shall show forth thy praise. We know it's a rough patch. We know it's down in the valley. It seems never ending. But Lord, I'm going to thank you. And hallelujah anyhow. Never let your problems get you down. For when temptation come your way, just lift your hands up high and say, hallelujah anyhow. Is a practice. I say to somebody at work that faith borders on fanaticism. And you people understand what I'm saying. Faith is fanatical. And people might think you'll be mad because you got to call those things that are not as though they are present. So I'm saying, some man do not see the thing and you keep saying it, think you're mad. It may look like a fanatic because you're speaking faith. But though you speak like that, it's more than that. He's not looking through the lens that you're looking at. He's not seeing the things you're seeing. The prophet said, for God does it, then he reveals it. And when you begin to praise him and thank him, he's going to bring it to pass. No matter what the circumstances, no matter what the problem is, you got to begin to trust in God.
It's not about where you come from. Or you think you come from, rather. Because I said before, you come from God. It's not round a thing there. Round a mountain, round a pot of mountain, round so. A thing like that, or you come from up a Berkshire Hall, or you come from where the place name about Guy's Hill, or you come from Rona, when I Woodlands Round, so, or whatever the place may be you come from. Or some come from Cane River, and some come from Westmoreland, and all these places. It's more than that where you come from. If you did not come from God, you cannot go back to God. For no man go to heaven except him that come down from heaven. See what I'm saying? You can't just go in a God presence. And you think you can, don't it? Esther could not go in the king's presence unless he had beckoned for her to come. She knew she was dead, don't it? She got to come in at a certain time. Eh? Same way with God Almighty. We came into the world, David said, speaking lies, born in sin and shaped in iniquity. But God is a perfect God. And if you're going to reign with him, you got to be perfect too. Therefore, he knows what he wants you to be. He's got to make you perfect. The word said, for he sent Jesus Christ to be a propitiation for your sins. Means that he's going to stave off any penalty. Because there's going to be a payment coming. For the wage of sin is death. But the gift of God. So the propitiation now pay the penalty for you. He lay in the way for you. He formed the breach for you. That you don't have to do this by yourself. You don't have to get up early in the morning and think about a whole day of doing something. And then a carry a stick up a mountain or carry a stone up a mountain. Or go up on a 40-day fast because you go fast like that. Although some people use it to lose weight. When they say them, I go up on a, what the fast name? One 40-day fast. Them have some people have at the beginning of the year. What are the riverside fasting again? You understand? When they say we're going fast for 40 days. My mother used to do that. My mother used to fast 20 days and 40 days and like that. And cook cereal around the house. Tell Jesus, really, bread, Mark, I'm not going to fast 40 days. That had no fasting. But you don't have to fast 40 days. The work of grace is Jesus working on you. You did not save yourself. You did not justify yourself. You cannot sanctify yourself. You cannot fill yourself with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. You cannot do that. If you do that, then you don't need God. If you can do all of that, clean up yourself and do all that, you don't need God. But God knows you can do that for yourself. He made a way where there seemed to be no way. And today in your life, he will work in ways that you cannot see. Amen. He will make a way for you. Amen. You believe that? Amen. You believe that? Amen. That no matter where you have been and the things you have done, you have not gone so far that God cannot touch you, that God cannot use you. He used a prostitute, didn't he? He used one born out of incest. And so much. There's David who murdered one. Not you? Send him to dead and take away a woman and things like that. You know what David did? Yeah, man. When he planned wouldn't work, he decides he don't ever kill him. Don't it? But did God say not David? But Jesus Christ came through the same lineage, didn't he? The lineage of a prostitute, one of incest, one who sleep with her father-in-law, one who murdered him and take away his wife. All him say, God, he came through a line that you think a God could not come through. The God line must be perfect. Nothing could it. And you wonder, where your father there? Your father was a drunkard or a murderer or something. Why God can't dwell? Don't worry about that. It's not your work. You're looking at this and that. But God is looking at his image in you. His likeness and image to be perfect in you. It's not where you come from, where you thought you came from. It's all about the grace
of Almighty God. You believe that? You believe that? Bow your heads a minute. Lord, we do thank you, God. For you are God alone, Almighty God. Lord, the one who we look to for our sustenance, Lord. For there is none like unto you in all the earth. Lord, as we come bowing our hearts to you one more time, Lord. Having failed so many times. Start and stop and rise and fall and rise and fall and rise and fall. And sometimes, God, we feel like this is impossible. We just turn around and turn back and don't continue. Because, Lord, we can't do it. But, Lord, we cannot do it, God. We accept that we cannot do it, Lord. You know we can't do it, God. But, Lord, we stand by your grace today, Lord. We stand by your grace, Almighty God. The Lord, that you'll come, Lord God. And take our desires, Lord. Take our commitments to you, Lord God. And Lord God, don't forget our labor of love. Lord God, I pray, God, today. The Lord, when we go from here, God, God, with renewed determination, Lord. Lord God, like Joseph, that though it may seem dark, though it may seem unending, but I will not let go. I will not let go. Like Jacob, Almighty God, I will not let go until you bless me, Almighty God. I will not let go, God, until you deliver me. Lord, I've come past this mountain so long. Lord, when you come, Lord God, have mercy upon me according to thy loving kindness. According unto the multitude of thy tender mercies, God, blot out all our transgressions. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Make me to know joy and gladness, Lord, that the bone just has to be broken. May rejoice. Lord, we thank you, God. Lord, we honor you. Lord, we adore you, Lord, because truly you're worthy to be. Remember the varying needs and requests in our midst, Almighty God. And as we go from here, go with us. Separate your love within our hearts, Lord. We're depending on you for divine leadership, Lord God. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Amen.